Hello friends, welcome to video lecture number 19. In this video, we shall discuss the analysis and design of basic BJT Astable Multivibrator. I am Dr. Samarth Borkar from Goa College of Engineering. This is the disclaimer. The information presented in this presentation is meant to supplement and not to replace professional guidance or training. Refer the class handouts and recommended textbooks for in-depth understanding of the concepts. Astable multivibrator is also referred to as free-running multivibrator, which has no stable states. Its output oscillates continuously between two unstable states. These unstable states are also referred to as quasi-stable states without the aid of any external triggering. Now, if we try to understand the working of monostable or bistable multivibrators, these multivibrators, they require external source of triggering. For example, in case of monostable, you require one trigger pulse to change the state from one stable state to another quasi-stable state. Whereas in case of bistable multivibrator, both the states are stable states, so you require two triggering pulses to switch the states in between. Let us have a look at the construction of the Astable multivibrator. So it consists of two transistors, Q1 and Q2. Practically, you can make out these are NPN transistors. So we can make use of BC107 or CL100 transistors. The collector of transistor Q1. So here is the collector terminal. This is the base terminal and emitter terminal. Likewise, base, collector and emitter. These two transistors are connected in feedback fashion and it employs a positive feedback. So you can make out the collector of transistor Q1. So here is the collector of the transistor Q1 is connected to the base of transistor Q2 and the output, that is the collector terminal, is connected to the base of the first transistor. Emitters of both the transistors are connected to ground. Here I have shown an LED. When you switch on the circuit, either of the transistors goes into saturation first or conduction mode first, or one of the transistor gets on. So if I assume this transistor goes into conduction first, then this LED will glow. So this is just an indication to show like which transistor is conducting and which is not. The C1 and C2 are of equal values, so is R1 and R2. Typically this R1 equals to R2. Now in this diagram, we can see there are two transistors which are connected as a switch. Now to understand how the transistor acts as a switch, you can refer to our video lecture 14 titled as Transistor as a Switch. So when transistor Q1 is on, so I'll write here. So when transistor Q1 is on, its collector and emitter acts as a short circuit. So here, the collector and the emitter of transistor Q1 acts as a short circuit, but when it is in off condition, it acts as an open circuit. So the same transistor Q1, when it is in off condition, this collector emitter terminal, it acts as an open circuit. So in this circuit, when a transistor is in off state, its collector will have a voltage VCC, and when it is in on state, its collector will be grounded. So when one transistor is in on state, the other transistor will be in off state. And the off time of this transistor is determined by RC time constant. It determines the on and off time of the transistors, which actually reflects the output waveform. When the circuit is switched on, one of the transistor will be more conducting than the other transistor due to imbalance in the circuit or the difference in the parameters of the transistor. Gradually, the more conducting transistor will be driven to saturation and less conducting transistor will be driven to cutoff. So there are just two states here. When I say transistor is acting as a switch, there is a possibility of just two states. One, a transistor can be either on or transistor can be off. When the transistor is in on state, we say the transistor has gone into saturation. And when the transistor is in off state, we say the transistor is working in cutoff mode. If I take a simple transistor as a switch, so let me write here, this is VCC, a collector resistor RC, and output is taken from this terminal. Input is applied to the base. So we can write the output equation VCE equals to VCC minus IC into RC. So the first condition is, when the transistor is off, in this condition, when the transistor is off, the current passing through the transistor is zero. So we can write IC equals to zero. So if I substitute IC equals to zero in this equation, then what we get is, in cutoff condition, the output voltage VCE is equal to VCC. Typically, VCC is, depending upon the selection of transistor, it varies from 6 to 18 volts. Secondly, when the transistor is in saturation, now what makes this transistor on? Sufficient amount of base current. So this base current has to be greater than IB minimum, which is required to switch the transistor to on condition. Now, how this IB is related to IC? In simplest term, IC is equal to beta times IB, where beta is the transistor gain. So when the transistor is in the saturation mode, heavy current of IC is going to pass through the circuit, which is limited by the value of RC. So here we are going to have a voltage drop. So when a transistor is on, the output current is high, but the output voltage VCE is near about zero. So we call this voltage as VCE set. Practically it is 0.2 volts depending upon the make of the transistor. So if I talk about the power, power is V into I. So we can check out for two conditions for cutoff. In cutoff condition, the current I is zero, so the power will be zero. And in case of saturation condition, as we have discussed, output voltage VCE equals to zero. So again, the power reduces to zero. So when the transistor is shifting from one state to another state, the power dissipation ideally has to be zero. So it should not consume any power for switching operation. Next, I'll discuss about the working of this transistor circuit. So when the circuit is switched on, one transistor will be driven into saturation. So let me write here, one transistor will be driven into saturation, that is on state, and the other will be driven to cutoff. Now we are going to assume that transistor Q1 is on and transistor Q2 is off. So these are our two assumptions. During this time, capacitor C2 is charging to VCC through resistor R. Now, the assumption that what we have made here is, this transistor Q1 is on and transistor Q2 is off. Since the transistor Q1 is on, the current is going to pass through this circuit and this will light the LED. This will be in the off state. So, during this state, when Q1 is on and Q2 is off, the capacitor C2 is going to charge to VCC through resistor R. This will be the path for charging of the capacitor. Q2 is off due to the negative voltage. Now, though we assume that Q2 is off, we try to trace the circuit. This is NPN transistor and PN transistor. The base of this NPN transistor, which is positive, is getting connected to the negative polarity. So Q2 is indeed off due to the negative voltage from the discharging capacitor C1. So when this transistor is on, this capacitor C1 will discharge through this path. The earlier state, this capacitor C1 was charged to a value of VCC. So the off time of Q2 is determined by R1 C1 time constant. So this values of R1 and C1 is going to decide for how long this transistor Q2 is going to remain in the off state. So revisit this statement: when the transistor Q1 is on, capacitor C2 is going to charge through this path which has been highlighted, and capacitor C1 is going to discharge after a time period as decided by R1 C1. So we call it as a time constant R1 C1. The product of R1 C1 is referred to as time constant. Upon the values of R1 and C1, and as the capacitor C1 discharges completely and starts charging in the reverse direction through R1, this will switch the transistor Q2 to on condition. Now what we have assumed here, this capacitor C1 is going to discharge. Previously it was charged to a value of VCC. So if I look from this end, it is minus VCC. So it will discharge, and the value across this capacitor will be less and less negative. That will be, it will be going towards the positive end. And when this voltage across C1 reaches the cut-in voltage of value 0.5, then this transistor, because this voltage across this capacitor is available to the base of transistor Q2. So the moment this capacitor voltage reaches the cut-in voltage of this transistor will go into on condition. Now that we'll discuss with the next figure. Previous understanding, when this capacitor C1, when it charges to a value sufficient enough to provide a base emitter voltage of 0.7 to the transistor Q2, this transistor Q2 is switched on and capacitor C2 starts discharging. So this capacitor C2 starts discharging and this capacitor starts charging. For the state when the transistor Q2 is on, so there is a current passing through this part of the circuitry. So you can safely write here, this capacitor transistor Q2 being on is discharging, and when it is discharging, it is receiving this negative from capacitor 2. So we are applying negative voltage to the NPN transistor, so this will drive the transistor Q1 to off state. If this is driven to off state, there won't be any current, it will act as an open circuit. This will stop glowing, and since this transistor is conducting the current, this LED which is connected over here starts glowing. The negative voltage from the capacitor C2 turns off the transistor Q1. So I can write here negative voltage from capacitor C2 turns off the transistor Q1. Capacitor C1 starts charging from VCC to resistor R and the base emitter of transistor Q2, thus the transistor Q2 remains in on state. So this is the condition for transistor Q2 to remain in on state. In this state, the capacitor C2 had discharged completely. Now it starts charging towards VCC in opposite direction through R2. So when the voltage across capacitor C2 is sufficient enough, previous state the capacitor C2 had discharged completely. Now it starts charging towards VCC in opposite direction through R2. So when the voltage across capacitor C2 is sufficient to turn on the transistor Q1, because the voltage at this point is connected to the base of the transistor Q1, then Q1 will be turned on and capacitor C1 will again start discharging. So the moment this transistor again becomes or goes into on state, this capacitor C1 start to discharge, and this process is continuous, and it produces a rectangular waves at the collector of each transistors. We have to make a note here, the charging time is very less as compared to the discharging time. For condition transistor Q2 is on, in that case the output voltage, or I can write VCE, will be zero. If I take this as a reference, is zero, and during the same interval transistor Q1 will be off. In that case output voltage will be equals to VCC. So we are going to get a voltage VCC, and this cyclic process is going to generate an output waveform of this fashion. When transistor Q2 is on, output is zero. When transistor Q2 is off, output is high. And conversely, we are going to get output in the opposite direction for transistor Q1. Now these are the waveforms obtained across the two transistor outputs. So we can make out, so when transistor Q2 is off, so we'll mark this as T equals to 0, stands for transistor 2, and subscript 1 stands for transistor 1. So when the base voltage of transistor Q2 is 0.7, that will drive the transistor to on condition, and when the transistor is on, output voltage is near about equal to 0, that is VCE set. So here in this case the transistor Q2 is on, and during this time interval transistor Q1 has to remain in the off state. So when the transistor Q1 is in the off state, output is high. Theoretically what we expect is a square waveform, but then here we get kind of a curve. This is what is referred to as rounding. When a unstable multivibrator is switched, we have the following condition. Transistor Q2 is in saturation region and transistor Q1 is in off region. So if this is the case, then we can write C2 at T equals to 0 is VCE set, we'll mark this as 1, IC2 set will be equal to VCC minus VCE set divided by RC2. VB on will be equal to VBE set. So we'll mark this as equation 3. Assume this at T equals to 0, at this time interval, transistor Q2 is in saturation region. So if the transistor is in saturation region, the output will be VCE set, and when the transistor Q1 is in off state, the output will be high. Let's discuss about the frequency of oscillation. Now in the first case, let us assume transistor Q1 is conducting and Q2 is off. Hence VC1 equals to 0 volts and VC2 equals to VCC. Now due to the higher voltage at VC2, the capacitor C2 will be charged via R4. So this capacitor C2 will be charged via R4 with this as the polarity. Due to higher voltage at VC2, capacitor C2 will be charged via R4. It will offer the low resistance path because R4 is less than R2. What about the capacitor C1? Now C1, which was earlier charged, it cannot hold the charge for indefinite period, so it will start discharging via R2. So this capacitor C1 is going to discharge via R2. Now this is high resistance path because R2 is greater than R1. Now the taken up by the capacitor C1 to discharge is greater than the time taken to charge C2. So we can write to discharge capacitor C1, let us denote as T1. So it is R2 C1, which is greater than the time taken to charge T2. For time interval T2 equals to R4 and C2. So discharge of C1, time will be greater as compared to charging of C2. When C2 is fully charged, then the left plate of C2 will be at minus VCC. Switch off the transistor Q1. And when C1 is fully discharged, then left plate of C1 will be at plus VCC, which will switch on the transistor Q2. That will be the state 2. So when VB2, that is the base voltage of transistor Q2, reaches to a value of V on, the circuit enters into state 1 again, and then the process repeats. This is what we have discussed, the time period of the wave. This is what is the wave structure. When this is low, the output of the transistor Q1 will be high, and so on. Now the time period of the wave depends only upon the discharge of capacitors C1 and C2. So consider VB2 during discharge of C2. So what we can write is VB2 equals to VCC minus IC1 into R2. Since the capacitor C1 is charged up to VCC, the initial discharge current will be IC1, can be written as VCC plus VCC by R2. The current decays exponentially with the time constant of R2 C1. So it exponentially decays with this time constant. So what we can write is VB2 equals to VCC minus of twice VCC e to the power minus t R2 C1. Now the transistor will be switched on when VB2 equals to 0 volts. Now practically speaking, it has to be 0.7 for silicon and 0.3 for germanium. Now which is very small as compared to VCC. So what we can write is, you can write this as 0 VCC minus twice of VCC, and this term e raised to minus t upon R2 C1 can be written as 2 e raised to minus t R2 upon C1 equals to 1. So 2 is the off time for transistor Q2, so will be R2 C1 natural log of 2. So what is T2? T2 is the, I'll write here, off time of transistor Q2. Similarly, the off time for transistor Q1 can be obtained, and what we can write is T equals to T1 R3 C2 natural log of 2. So the total time period T to T1 plus T2, so we just substitute, it is R3 C2 plus R2 C1, common term natural log of 2, so it is 0.694 R3 C2 plus R2 C1. If we consider R2 equals to R3 equals to R, and C1 equals to C2 equals to C. Now don't confuse this R with the collector resistor. So in that case, T equals to 1.38 RC. So this is the total time period, and what we are interested in finding is the frequency of oscillation. So frequency of oscillation f is 1 by t, so near about 0.7 by RC is the frequency of oscillation. So now we'll try to understand the working of Astable Multivibrator from numerical point of view. So here equals to R2 equals to R or equals to 47 kilo ohms, C1 equals to C2 equals to C equals to 0.01 microfarad. So we have the same circuit diagram. RC. So this is C2, R2, R1, C1, transistor Q1. Since we have taken R1 equals to R2 equals to R and C1 equals to C2, this is symmetric Astable Multivibrator. So we can write T equals to 1.38 RC. So substitute the values 1.38 into 47 kilo 10 to the power 3 into 0.01 into 10 to the power minus 6. So if you solve this, the answer is 0.648 milliseconds and frequency f is 1 by t. So it is 1 upon 0.648 into 10 to the power minus 3, which equals to 1.54 kilohertz. And then you write the answer. The time period is 0.648 milliseconds and the frequency of oscillation is 1.54 kilohertz. So what we can comment from this entire exercise, that the frequency of oscillation purely depends upon the value of an R1 C1. Next problem, R1 is 20k and R2 is 30k. Now these are typically R1 and R2, and these are the capacitors. The capacitor values are same. So this is purely a case of unsymmetric Astable Multivibrator. So the timing periods will be different. So we have derived T2 equals to 0.69 into R1 C1 and T1 is 0.69 R2 C2. Now we are going to substitute the values of R1 and R2 accordingly. So it is 0.69 into 20 into 10 to the power 3 into 0.01 into 10 to the power minus 6. So this value is 0.2 milliseconds and here 0.69 into 30 into 10 to the power 3 into 0.01 into 10 to the power minus 6 equals to 0.138 milliseconds. The total time period T equals to T1 plus T2, which equals to 0.138 plus 0.2 milliseconds, that is 0.338 milliseconds. What is asked? Calculated duty cycle. Now what we mean by duty cycle? It is the T on divided by total time period. The total time period is T on plus T off. So percent D equals to T1 upon T into 100%. So if I calculate this, 0.138 divided by the time period is 0.338 into 100%. So it is 59.17% is the duty cycle T on time, and frequency is also asked. The frequency is 1 by T. So if you substitute 1 by T is how much? 0.338 into 10 to the power minus 3. So it is 2.95 kilohertz. Now what is being reflected here is, it's very difficult to get a T on time less than 50% for a stable multivibrator. What is the given data? So I'll not redraw the circuit again here. So given data is, what is missing data here is the value of VCC. Now check out the VCC set is 0.2 and the peak to peak amplitude is 10 volts. So we can take VCC equals to multiple of 1.5 near about to 10 is 12 volts. Now we start solving the problem. T equals to 1 by F. So 1 upon 10 into 10 to the power 3. So time is 0.1 milliseconds. It is mentioned as symmetric multivibrator. Hence, what we can write is R1 equals to R2 equals to R and C1 equals to C2 equals to C. Likewise, we can say T1 equals to T2. Both the time periods will be equal of T on as well as T off, which equals to half of total time period. So T is 0.1 divided by 2, it is 0.05 millisecond. It's a design problem, so we have to the components. So to calculate RC2, so right here RC2, we can write the equation RC2 as VCC minus VCE set divided by IC set. This is from the output equation that we have discussed earlier. 10 minus 0.2 into 10 to the 2 into 10 to the power minus 3. It is 4.9 kilo ohms. So RC1 equals to RC2 equals to 4.9 kilo ohms. Calculate R2. So I'll write here. R2 is VCC minus V cut in divided by IB2 set. So IB2 minimum equals to IC set divided by HFE minimum. Now what is IB2 minimum? IB2 minimum is the value of base current, minimum value of base current which is required to trigger the transistor to on condition, which is to HFE minimum, which again is given in the problem statement. So we can calculate IB2 minimum as 2 milliamperes divided by 30. So it is 0.066 milliamperes. Q2 is in saturation. So I'll write here, if Q2 is in saturation, meaning on condition, output voltage VC will be 0. So I have to calculate what is the actual current that goes into the transistor Q2 to go in on state, that is saturation. And IB2 saturation is typically 1.5 times IB2 minimum. So if I substitute values, the answer is 0.099 milliamperes. So from this I can get the value of R2 as 10 minus 0.7 divided by 0.099 milli, so 10 to the power minus 3 equals to 93.9 kilo ohms. So R1 equals to R2 is 93.9 kilo ohms, and as C1 equals to C2, we can write T1 as 0.69 R2 C2. From this I can calculate the value of C2 as 0.05 into 10 to the power minus 3 divided by 0.69 into 93.9 into 10 to the power 3. So this is equals to 771.7 picofarad, and as C1 equals to C2, the value of C2 again is 771.7 picofarad. So our design is complete. We are able to get the value of R1, R2
RCN C1 C2.
So this completes our design problem. Move on to the advantages and the disadvantages. The very first advantage is we don't require any kind of triggering here for a stable multivibrator, whereas in case of a bistable or monostable, we do require the triggering pulses to change the states of the output waveform. The circuit design is very simple. All the passive component except from the transistor Q1, Q2, Q, and it will function continuously. These are the disadvantages. The third one is the important one, which we already have discussed. We cannot get a duty cycle less than 50%. And these are the applications. You can go through the applications. And these are some of the review questions. What type of distortion is observed in the Astable multivibrator? So if you refer to that output waveform figures, the collector waveforms, typically what is expected is this kind of a wave shape. But instead of this, what we get is this as the output wave shape. So this is what is referred to as rounding, and which is undesirable and it should be eliminated. And next, what is an Astable multivibrator? So it is a two-stage switching circuit in which the output of first stage is fed to the input of the second stage and vice versa. And the output of both stages are complementary. So when one's output is high, the other output has to be low for that time interval. It has two quasi-stable states. Both are unstables. They are not stable, they are quasi-stable. And it switches back and forth from one state to another state depending upon the discharging of the capacitive circuits. So with this, we come to an end of the analysis and the design of basic BJT Astable multivibrator. For more useful content and detailed information, you can visit my website. I have uploaded lecture notes, tutorials, lab manuals and assignment with past IT and the semester and examination question papers. If you are interested, you can also access video tutorials on GPSC, CBIT and mains exam preparation, which I uploaded here on the very same channel, Goa Entertainment Company, which is again free of cost. So if you have any doubts or any clarification, kindly post them in the comment section. Thank you.